forget about vacation Bible school tomorrow. That's those are on the script head after the service. Or the kids are looking for the script. You can get the script so you have to know when you figure out how much paper around. So if you're able to even take them with you and bring them in the morning, that would be great if you have a list to go ahead and please get your kids registered. And if you have your Bibles, turn over to the book of Ephesians chapter number 6. Ephesians chapter number 6. Last week during the afternoon, we did a study on putting on the whole armor of God, and we're going to continue on that study. We're going to talk about the belt of truth today, because don't we need the truth more than ever? We need the truth more than ever. I'm not talking about politically, even. Okay? I'm not talking about all the media is lying to you. No, we need the truth more than ever. And this is the truth we're talking about today. Are you not some political thing or something like that talking about the word of God? Because truly the truth is under attack today. The devil has always been about attacking the truth. And lying. And the Bible calls him the father of lies. He's a liar and the father of lies. This world is so full of deceit and lies. It seems everyone will spin the truth to cut their back. When we benefit them, that goes from kids all the way up to adults. We want to put our own spin on it so it doesn't make us look bad. But the world is so full of lies. The lies that have been spread throughout the world have done damage to how we live. It has changed. You just go back 40, 50, 60 years ago. And man, even America has changed a lot. What's happened? The church, in general, has been getting to believe lies that are contrary to the word of God. Ephesians 6:14, it says this. Well, let's just go back to verse 9, and I'll read through verse 14. Finally, my brother, verse 10, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that he may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having been all to stand. Verse 14, first we go over today, the first part. Stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, the belt of truth. The first part of this message, we're going to just kind of talk about the Roman belt that they would use, the soldier used at this time period. And then we'll get into why that's important for them. Our lives are not, why the truth is so important in our lives. And why the truth should be the main focal point of our life. Because once you start not believing the truth and you start believing lies, everything will fall apart. Everything will fall apart. But the Roman belt consisted of two belts, a cross. You've seen our cross on the other belt. You've seen the two leather straps and a cross on one belt. They would hold the sword. The other belt would have like a small dagger. Have you seen a picture of the soldier? Like a bike's belt across their belly. The belt was also used to tuck in their cloak. You see how sometimes they're, they tune it around their throat. Their cloak was so long that they would tuck it into their belt so they were able to climb more easily. They didn't wear clothes like they wear today. They would have these long clothes and clothes that they would tuck into their belt. I do have some couple of quotes about the belt that are very interesting. These quotes come from an article titled "The Roman Military Belt" by Stephanie Lawson in academia. There's one where it says, neither the tunica nor the cloak seem to have different meaning from the soldier to the average well of civilian clothing. So when the Roman soldier was not in full armor, you could still identify a Roman soldier. If you don't identify them, the truly distinguishing fact of the military dress were the sandals and the military belt. You look at a well-off citizen and you see that the same kind of clothing, but there was one thing that was different, the belt. You got to find that's a soldier. That person has the belt. The belt, if it invests with meaning to such an extent that taking away the military belt of a soldier in public for hours or days was a humiliation. Used as a disciplinary measure by their superiors. To pay attention to their opponents and their strengths. But you also need to know their bent. He was having pointed that there was a bell was the significance of their soldier, but made them so because the stakes in that was the bell. That bell would be taken away from them to punish them, taken away the military, but currently after that situation or during a dishonorable discharge from the army seems to have been part of this. So they would also take away the dishonorable discharge, the dishonorable discharge. They would want to keep it, was taken away from them. The significance of the belt as a symbol of being a soldier continued on into the late empire, as a state figure being a symbolic act of Christian soldiers stands openly refusing to remain in the army and for life there, no drinking. So they said, we quit, but if we need to go off, I can hold it. I don't like it, it's off their back. So the bell was symbolic of being a soldier. The military bell of the Roman soldier can therefore be defined as a symbolic object. Both as a part of clothing and a piece of military equipment, setting the soldier apart from civilian men and even as a miles for a soldier. So what set him apart from everybody else was the fact that he had this belt. And he wore it. Everyone. And it says, let's go to the part. So we have the truth. The word of God. We have the truth. It separates us and sets us apart. The bell was so important that the many military men had their belt buckles or any reflected their belts bigger than they had. So the bell was just a focal point of the soldier, the Roman soldier, was a symbolic piece of military, of the military. But let's get into why the belt is so important. Some of those stats that the military I believe there's a correlation between the Roman soldier's belt and our belt of truth. First of all, this is technical device that keep the better Christians in America. According to statistics of the device here in 2021, 63% of Americans still claim to be Christian. You look at the number you know. Well, first of all, the statistics that will shock you and be like, if 63% of America was really Christian, we wouldn't believe some of the lies that are happening. Okay, first, let's talk about abortion. Abortion is wrong. Jeremiah 1, verse 4 and 5 talks about it, but you, Jeremiah, when you find yourself, I told you, before it was an abortion, I knew you. And we see John the Baptist weeping in the world with joy, having a secret as an unborn baby. Here's the law that many Christians still today believe it both has to be in the first trimester. Somewhere between 50 to 70% of Americans believe that Roe versus Wade may be overturned. Now, as I said, most of it is political, so I'm not getting into abortion specifically. Okay? If all the so called Christian churches stand against abortion, we can make a difference. In fact, 63% claim to be Christian. How in the world up to 70% of Americans approve of abortion being okay in the first trimester, even further? If 63% are Christian, following how they totally disconnect from the truth and God's word, that's a complete disconnect. Christians are starting to believe it's okay. Have an abortion. It's okay. Another example is homosexuality. Okay. According to Gallup, 70% of Americans support are okay with gay marriage. 70%! Okay? According to the statistics, only 37% of Americans should be okay with it because they're 63% percentage of Christian. That's a whopping at least 35% of those persons believe that homosexuality is okay. That's not what the Bible says! Bible tells us in Romans 1 that it is an abomination. That it is deceitful, it's wicked. You go to Leviticus and says it's unseemly, it's detestable, it's ugly, it's wrong, it's sin. Okay? So the Bible teaches. Here's another one. The Bible is just a book. It's a contrary interpretation. In 2017, it's an anti-deliverance combined since then. According to Gallup, only 24% of Americans believe the Bible is the Bible. Only 24 64%. 63% is a Christian. It's happening. The truth is being destroyed. If the foundation of the world is being destroyed, if the foundation of the world is being destroyed, the foundation of the commerce of this country is being destroyed by lies and deceit. 47% believe it was inspired. It's up for interpretation. It's got to be that the Bible contains the word of God. It's not if the word of God, but it contains it. That if it speaks to you, then yes, you have to talk the word of God to you. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scriptures are the inspiration of God. So things make sense. There's another statistic. Divorce is morally acceptable. According to Statista, research development, 79% of Americans think that divorce is morally acceptable. 4% believe it depends on the situation, 7% believe it is morally wrong. I don't believe it's morally wrong, but there are a few exceptions that God did make for that. Few exceptions, very few. But here's what Jesus said himself. What God has joined together, let not man put asunder. So God has said, 80% say it is morally acceptable, it's okay. No wonder you see the divorce rate, you see the homosexuality and all these other things spiking, right? It's because people are believing lies. And when they believe lies, when you get this deception, and please play your part to this, when they believe lies, they begin to do the wrong things. Okay? That's why the truth is so important. If you don't believe the truth, you're going to end up doing the wrong things. You're going to come to the wrong conclusion about stuff. If you believe the truth, you come to the right conclusion of why this world is and why it's so important. But let's get into just the truth is our identity. The truth is our identity. Remember, James, the truth is our identity. The truth is what makes us different from the rest of the world. The truth is what makes us soldiers. Because if there's no truth, what are we fighting for? If there's no word of God, if there is no scripture that's been given to us, then what are we fighting for? If Jesus Christ is the Apostle Paul, but he's still dead and buried, everything we do is worthless. He said in 1 Corinthians 15, if he be not risen, you're still dead in your sins. So if this book is false and it's not true, what are we doing here? Right? But it is true. And because it is true, we have something to stand on, something to fight for, something to hold on to. We need the belt of truth. Christians around the world need to believe what the Bible says to be true. And I'm not talking about standards. I'm not talking about what the Bible says is wrong. We say it's wrong. If the Bible says it's right, we say it's right. If the Bible says homosexuality is wrong, it's wrong. If the Bible says it's wrong, this is the way your parents is. No, if the Bible says it's wrong, you fill in the blank, it's wrong to steal, it's wrong. If it's wrong to tell others about Jesus, then it's right. Right? This is why it's so important that we, as Christians, hold on to the truth that is in God's word. We need more Christians who are more concerned about the truth in this book than the truth that's being spewed out on TV or not. Okay? For example, sometimes I think what's happened to a lot of Christians has become a value that a public party will play. So, today we start taking like that party, party platform, and we're not putting it through the lens of God's word. We start fighting for the Republican Party is fighting for the Lord. You become more Americans than you become Christians. And then we forget what we're truly fighting for. And how we're following. We need this truth because this is what differentiates us from the world. Okay? It differentiates us from everything else. People should be able to spot that you're a Christian because of this. Or get spotted as a Christian, whatever you have happened. Let me tell you, you probably rely because you have the truth. the truth is what differentiates us from other people. We find the truth in the Word of God. The Roman soldiers want to bounce on this connection here. I could refer to like the Old Testament. Word of God. I'm an officer, and it's interesting to see. And think that maybe it could be where it refers to the Bible to bounce on the Old Testament. We need Christians who know what the Bible says. We need Christians who are in their Bible. Not on Fox News or other people in Christendom. We need Christians to get close to the Lord. Get close to Him. That He is the way, the truth, and the life. We need Christians to spend time reading and studying and memorizing and pouring their life into this book. We need Christians who will turn off the phone, turn off the TV, turn off our news, and get read the Word of God. Because this is what's going to help us defeat the devil. We talked about last week, the fight comes from the devil. Because we haven't put on the whole armor of God. Not prepared. Because the devil is a roaring lion walking about, seemingly made it out. If you're more hostile, I said that apparently the armor could be Jesus, right? For Jesus is the truth. Jesus is our righteousness. Jesus is the gospel. He is our faith, he is our faith, and he is our salvation, and what he is on earth. The Word of God will also be put in this one because God is the truth. We don't need to write it in you. But the gospel is in the Bible. The only salvation, where do we find salvation from? The Bible. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. So the faith, salvation from the Word, and of course, the Word is part of what's in the Word of God, which is connected to all. That's the truth. The truth in the Word of God, again, they go hand in hand. They go hand in hand. My pastor, Paul, I would say, if you take the Bible, and give them more of it, and put it in the Bible, you get Jesus. If you take Jesus and put it into a book, it's so very true. If Jesus is called the Word, he's given us the Bible. And lastly, the truth must be defended. Now, here's where it kind of gets tough. Because who are we really fighting? Are we fighting individuals? We're fighting the devil. So, if you're having problems with your kids, you need to fight the devil off. And if you're having trouble with the devil, it's probably been happening. Right? You have to look beyond and say there's an enemy that is trying to destroy our family and every time to destroy our country. So we see the problem in the country. Who's behind it? The devil. He's behind it. We don't fight against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. So we're fighting against the devil. But what the devil uses people to do his work. But how do you speak out of this work? And so people giving them claims. We have all the Bible talks about these things. He was able to have grace and truth. Right? Some of you have done this with your kids. Kids say something wrong and say something. I don't think Jesus told you the truth. And I know you've heard of that, right? But Jesus is telling the truth. But sometimes it doesn't need to be said. Or there's a better way of saying it. Sometimes the truth hurts. And let me say this, this is the adult way of thinking. If the truth offends, then it's okay. Right? So if it's offensive, that's okay. We can. But sometimes it's the way we say it that we're not. But it's going to fall. We go out and fight in the world, and we just start yelling at truth out of it. How is that good for them? How are you going to be able to teach them the truth if you're going out there fighting out there instead of fighting the devil? We're following. We're not going to get this world off for Christ by going after people. We're not. You ever had somebody come with a head of steam calling you out? That's pretty good. say that. And pretty soon it ends up being a fucking mess. And sometimes we need a little grace with our truth. The Bible says that we need to speak God from our faith.
I don't want to do it.
What do you say to you? Love your enemies. I think we as Christians are going away from the fact that we're talking about fighting. It's what happens when we get the truth. And we feel like we're defending the truth. And we're like, man, I don't really tell them a good one. Well, you know, you see those videos where somebody, you know, tells off a truth when it's pulled off a moment. And I'm so fucking bummed. So, well, what is God doing to increase their chances of coming to Christ? All they view now of you and all the people of the Christian that you contact with, right? They're just like, it's going to get clear, so they're just like, trying to be meaning. Not honest, true, honest discussion. You really want some people to be able to do that. You know, Pastor Coach before so long, right? There are things that people need to be called out. There's a good way of doing this. I mean, I don't think there's a proper way of dealing with that difficult discussion. What happens? It could be true what you say. You know, somebody you know, it could be true, right? But the way you go about it is so important. It's so important. Right? We need grace with truth. We need to feel comfortable. We need Christians who are so in love with the Word of God and so in love with Jesus that the love of God and Jesus so long in our lives to other people. I am going to want to see you, Lord. I am going to change somebody's heart about what is right and what's wrong. You show love like Jesus did. With his doing the public good of sins. You are nasty sinners, you devils. You know what Jesus did? Show what he did. He didn't get the truth. Yes, did he start going out and calling out sin by sin by sin by sin by sin? No. What he did is he started doing grace. And what happened? They come to him and they start confessing, and they're confessing it. And all of a sudden, she was like, woman, I can't. She wiped her face on his feet, drying tears on his feet, wiped all of his feet. And her face like, tears are spilling out of her. That woman was sitting on her arm, on her touch. She must not be interested. Now, to the place, she had done some terrible things. She had, and Jesus knew it too. And Jesus decided that the truth needed to be spoken at that point. Be like, you're terrible. You've done some fucking other things, bad things you've done. Imagine if he did that to you. That's how some of the Christians act. Right? There are some people who say, oh, I'm just a living person to that. Maybe somebody has gone to a church and they have put down on people. And that has to be where people have been holding high standards. And we should be a great Christian. Well, first of all, when it comes to standards, what we should really be concerned about with people is what the word faith has to say about things. Okay? What does God say about this? What does God say about that? If it's right, then the word of God is right. If it's wrong, then the word of God is right. I mean, we have different standards of how we interpret things. But we have to bring back to the Bible the truth. Truth, that's it, God's word. And sometimes we get so fixated on the outside, we forget about the inside. That's really important. And how does Satan attack the God's truth? It's pretty simple. What does he do? He lies. From the very first moment, God told Adam and Eve, don't eat of the tree. And Satan said, did God say, did God say that? He's not lying to you. I said, if you die, no, you're not going to die. And we see that happening in today's society. And I want to get into some of the lies that kind of Christians learn. That's what we might think. You know, some people think, oh, it's okay for this, it's great, and all those kind of people. You know, kids playing their video games, and kids playing their video games, and God saying, I'm free of the kids, and God's just 5 more minutes. I did it. And you justify disobeying your parents because I did it. Maybe the Bible's like, so you didn't obey your parents. So when you don't obey, it is sin. If you decide to put it off, it is sin. Can you justify it? happens is, if you first believe you're alive, then you just believe. Which is, it's okay if I do this. It's okay. It's going to take you every day. Or, what do you have to give us to give? That's the only everyone to give. And so, what some people say, I don't have any money to give this month, so I'm not going to give. So, you start to testify. You start to testify all around you, and you be like, I'm not going to say this, but my best friend, he gave this person in his office, he said, God is okay with me getting a divorce because God wants me to be happy. And because God wants me to be happy, it's okay. And thanks to a certain person, first of all, says, man, this is what I'm doing. Because God wants me to be happy. So, some good Bible verse where it says, God wants me to be happy. Now, does God want to see his children? All of us like to see our children happy. Not their face point over them, us being happy. But just looking at the future and seeing what the future holds. That's all parents know in this world. The future is what you're looking towards. Even if there is someone happy to understand, the future is what you're looking for. I'm going to wait for them to make my children happy. True, that maybe some things are working out, but if you want to see them again, it's worth it. It's worth it, right? And so then you begin to excuse and cry. Well, God says that we're supposed to be kind. It interferes our own, especially when teenagers want to be stubborn. And so we excuse our unkindness because it's our fault. We feel wrong that we know. Tell me what we have to do, what we can do. You know? Or if they wouldn't have done this, I would have done it back. For six years, and I know that was right. And if you're apparently not that close to a fan, and do that, you know what? But you have to trust that. The Bible says that. Be kind. So when you decide not to be kind, then you have the excuses. Or the way you justify in your mind, you're still going to be fault. Just move. See, the devil wants us to get away from this. Jeremiah, God told Jeremiah to all the people, said, my people, basically said, my people are dumb because they do not know his words. They didn't know. You know why they didn't know his words? They hadn't read it. Have you ever read the Bible through? Well, yeah. Have you ever studied any part of the Bible? It's not easy being in a battle. Because the devil is going to throw lie after lie after lie. I mean, you just look at what's happening with our kids today. Why are you even told this kid? If a boy can be a girl and this girl can be a boy. And kids are so confused because they're not taught the truth. And they're going to grow up being completely confused because, well, it's my truth. This is the truth. This is what the world needs. This is what Christians need. We need people who are in the Word of God, learning the truth, following, because when you start getting away from the truth, you are going to start doing things that are not right. That's why the belt of truth is one of the most important pieces of the armor. That is what the birthplace can have to do, but keeps it down. Is that the belt? The belt of truth. Where are you getting the truth from? Are you getting it from the Word of God? My dad used to say. Well, whatever. And there are people who will excuse their wrongdoing and say, well, I know the Bible says this, but anybody ever heard that before? I know the Bible says this, but this is what I have. Guess what? You just disobeyed the first commandment of the Ten Commandments. I don't know if God's going to find it, but he just put himself in the place of God. Because you think what you think is more important than God thinks. And this is the area you're at. You're real. This world does not need Christians who just float through life. You're happy that you go to a church, you're happy that you have the Word of God, but don't do anything with it. We need more Christians on the wants to see families destroyed. The devil wants to see the school destroyed. We need people who are willing to hold on to the truth of God's word. Because this book is true. And we have God with us. We spend time with him at the truth. The truth. Jesus and the Bible. When we hold on to it, we can stand in their fold. And we're going to come out the truth. And we have it. It's the thing. This world is steeped. It's a good point. I really mentioned this in Sunday school where somebody says something you don't know, and you feel that you're not going to lie. But we were so cynical as people because we just feel like people just lied or something. You may feel like that sometimes. There's like everybody's always lying. If you check the word of God and don't follow the word, this world needs Christians who will hold to the truth of God's word. We need people who want to speak the truth of God so we can win people. How close you hold to God's word? Is the truth with you every day? Because any day you can be a better. You can get to be a better. Think about the truth that you spend time on. The truth. Today. You spend time with the Lord today. You spend time with the Lord tomorrow. To get his grace, his love, still speaking the truth, standing for what is right. How many young people out there that have the face of heart, even if they're disappointed, they're just able to give you that thought that you just like. You don't feel like you're recommended at all, but you're living in a change. You know, how many people are people like that? They're just able to smooth things over, but yet they get their point across. That's one of the hardest traits to keep. Of David, who had a sword in his hand. He fought and fought and fought, and he would not let go of that sword. In fact, the Bible says he played with the sword, and he fearlessly had no fear of the sword, because it was just stuck around the sword, and he wanted it to be really good. When we talk about the sword experience of the Word of God, it's an excellent way to keep it in the Word of God. All the spiritual warfare is no joke. There are casualties all the time. You can be here for a while. You know, people have been here and gone and no longer exist. And you can drink from the Bible. The Bible says, do not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. So people will choose hope bottle when things are over. They don't even want to watch the NFL. They don't want to watch this or watch that. Or they have things going on and they put them in front of themselves. And that's not a good thing for you to do. Right? Because you're somebody that other things are more important than God. That's not good. And again, that's what the lies can do. Following the lies can do. And it's not to believe things that are not so important. You need precepts that are going to stand. Stand there for your word and your deeds that have the truth. And you begin to have the truth with you. You begin to do the right things. Does that mean you're going to be perfect? When you start doing the right thing, it protects you from regret and shame of making bad decisions. And some people might just start off here, right? Somebody else just might be right up here one day. Maybe it's just here. It's okay. The place is okay for this. It's okay for this. And then you see the bad thing here. You know, a person doesn't end up as a drug addict, whatever, just out of the blue. There are decisions that they make or the excuses in their mind parts of the truth that they want to lies. They want to detect them. And they want to detect them with their force. I'm so glad we have the Bible in our language. So glad. People give them God's voice to their voice. It's not. Let him sit on the wind. But you know, Adam does too. Sunday comes along. And I'm ready. You may fool the church, but you ain't fooling God. So we need to do tomorrow. How do we want to learn how to spread the truth? What are you going to do on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday? How are you going to fight those battles that need to come on any of those days? What's up here? Get the word of God. Martin Luther. He said you have to spend 2 to 3 hours in sermon, Bible reading, and prayer before the day of the day. So you need the strength to get to the day. Martin Luther was the one who was commanded by his son, Joseph. See what I mean? This is very amazing. He needed strength, and where did he get it from? The truth. The word of God. Exposing all the lies.